Sunrise on the equator. For a few brief moments, the snows of the great volcano Cotopaxi blush with pink before turning to gold. The sun climbs swiftly. To the east, far, far below, beneath the counterpane of cloud, the mighty Amazon rolls through a stifling world of tropical heat. 4 miles above strides a great avenue of volcanoes, locked in ice, caught in one of the severest climates in the world. Here men once sought El Dorado, blind to the jewels lying at their feet. Crystals of frozen dew. Dawn breaks the spell and life awakes. A hummingbird at 14,000 feet, the Chimborazo Hill Star, warmed by the first rays of the sun. Stretching restores muscles that have chilled to half their normal temperature during the bitter night. Wild lupin leaves survive a frosting of ice with the defense of little hares. Already the crystals are melting. A warm breeze soon clouds the slopes of the volcano Antisana. The ice cap, hundreds of feet thick, mocks the heat of the tropical sun. But on its lowest edge, within an hour of dawn, the frost has lost its grip. A stream bed, dry throughout the night, suddenly begins to sparkle. Today as every day, the waters of the Amazon once more set off on their journey to the sea. Across the icy plateau called the Paramo, 1,000 streams start along their way to join the brimming river. The wind begins to climb the lava cliffs, and from its crag, the Condor launches into cloud, hanging on wings almost 10 feet across. The Chimborazo Hill Star can nest at 15,000 feet, higher than almost any other bird. To keep such a tiny ball of feathers warm needs energy, and the birds depend on the chuquiraga flowers, which yield nectar abundant in sugar. Noisy groups of Andean plovers flock down to feed along the melting marshes. Beyond towers a third volcano, Cayambe. Wild horses, first brought to the Andes by Pizarro's conquistadors. The The condors are hungry too, searching and soaring in a silent sky. They can go for weeks without food, but today, an animal's misfortune has brought the promise of a meal. A wild horse has succumbed to age and infirmity, and the giant condor's turn has come. A mountain caracara, a kind of hawk, may be hungry too, but no bird quarrels with a condor. On the edge of a lava flow stands the condor's mate, and on a cold ledge, their chick waits to be fed. The male has now eaten his fill. Beneath the yellow patch on its breast, his crop is bulging with food. He walks uphill for an easier takeoff. The caracara has his chance. The condor flies farther past the full moon itself. On a narrow ledge whitened with droppings, the chick begs for food. Swaddled in a warm muff of feathers, it braces itself from falling off the nest. The adult regurgitates food directly into the chick's throat. In comparison, the caracara chicks feed almost daintily. As the sun climbs, the plateau beneath the volcanoes blazes with flowers, many forms and colors of gentians. Swarms of Atelopus toads leave their hiding places beneath the tussock grass to head for the streams. Their bodies are black to absorb the heat of the sun. Males grab the larger females to cling in an embrace which may last 3 weeks before the females at last reach water where they spawn. Thank you. plunge into a stream, which an hour before was ice, does nothing to cool their ardor. A Cyclades nests in a hole carved in a bank, banded with stripes like a layer cake, each laid down by a new eruption of ash or pumice from the giant volcanoes above. Rain and streams may wear down the Andes, washing them grain by grain to the Atlantic, but the volcanoes are still growing. Cotopaxi has not erupted for 100 years, but that's just a moment in the life of a volcano. Past eruptions have already built the strange world of the Paramo, where espalitias stand 13 feet high, like a field of mutant cabbages. The leaves must resist the intense ultraviolet light and the icy nights. Their hairy surface reflects radiation and keeps moisture on the outside so that they warm up quickly. Below them calls the plaintive antpitta. A little lower down the mountain lives the largest of all hummingbirds, each standing guard over his territory of nectar-bearing lobelia shrubs. Giant hummingbirds are bigger than swifts and feed on nectar as they hover. But the lobelia gets something in return. It dabs pollen on the bird's forehead from specially curved stamens. And when it flies to the next flower, the bird carries the pollen to its stigma to fertilize it. Both plant and bird benefit. But even in nature, there are thieves. The flower piercer attacks the petals at their base to take the nectar, using a scissor-like hooked bill. It robs the flower and gives nothing in return. The giant hummingbird is a fierce defender of its realm and drives off the flower piercer before returning to its favorite perch. But the story doesn't stop there. The shining sunbeam hummingbird also likes nectar, and it too cheats the flower by using holes made by the flower piercer. Its bill is too short to reach in from the end. The highlands of Ecuador have more kinds of hummingbirds than anywhere else in the world, dazzling in their gleaming iridescent plumage. Their forms are as wonderful too. Some have enormous tails. Others, immense bills evolved to feed from long flowers. These tropical highlands conceal other beasts, larger than birds. They're one of the few remaining homes for the spectacled bear, the only bear of South America, now hunted to the edge of extinction. Where the grasslands give way to cloud forest, the world of the bear begins. But we leave the condor behind. To the east of the Andes, below 10,000 feet, there is no open ground, and the condor cannot land. As the mountains fall to the east, mists cling to the forested slopes, a world of chasm, cloud, and rain. Almost impassable on foot, and little explored even today. The many hundreds of Amazon tributaries have grown. The forest that shrouds their valleys rings to the cries of strange birds. And appropriately, in a land of constant rain, the umbrella bird dangles its grotesque hanging wattle and displays its parasol of plumes. This immense, precipitous, trackless forest may remain the last unexplored wilderness on Earth, a realm of cataracts and gleaming birds. The cock of the rock is a fruit-eating bird, and it's easy to find fruit in the forest. The male doesn't help at the nest, so it can afford to be colorful. Its amazing color helps it to show off to other males and bid for females. But being colorful also attracts the attention of some of the many birds of prey that fly above the forest. So the cocks conceal their finery high beneath the crowns of thick trees, where they dance to each other, jumping round on the branches. Bobbing and rustling their feathers and squawking for hours at a time, always in the hope of outshining their companions to win the females. The increasing warmth as we go north, the water and the fertile ash from the volcanoes causes the trees to flourish, and they themselves become gardens hung with other plants, aroids, epiphytes, orchids, and bromeliads. Some are their own little watery worlds. A vermilion tanager and a paradise tanager. A startling glimpse of the incredible variety of birds that live below. The rivers roar down the last few thousand feet till they plunge off the edge of the Andes. At San Rafael in northern Ecuador, the Coca River falls nearly 500 feet. The rivers, which run from the foot of the Andes, are only 800 feet above sea level, but they have 2,500 miles to go before they reach the sea. The whole immense area of rainforest, which takes 4 hours to cross in a jet, is like a gigantic sponge saturated with water. Near the rivers, it's flooded for up to half the year, and the rivers constantly change their meandering course as they pulse with the rise and fall of the rains. Only a tiny fraction of the water in the rivers runs to the sea. Most is evaporated into huge thunderclouds, to fall as rain over and over again. The tropical rainforest, where water dominates the land and its creatures. The largest of all snakes is the anaconda, which lives in the rivers. Usually it hunts by night, lying submerged in the water. As animals come to drink, it grabs them with its jaws, coils round them, drags them into the river, and drowns them. A green jay sounds the alarm. After a rainstorm in the foothills, the rivers may rise more than 30 feet and are brown with sediment washed from the mountains. The Andes are flowing by. Whole trees are felled when the riverbanks are washed away. But the silt is a vital source of minerals for the forest floodplain. Primitive Hoatzins take to the air in clumsy flight. Turtles haul out to sun themselves. The river is a strange world of its own. The black caiman, the largest South American alligator. A tapir comes up for air. Tapirs, surprisingly, are relatives of the rhinoceros. They are primitive animals and completely at home in the water. Their strange double-barreled trunk is used for collecting leaves as well as smelling. Freshwater dolphins, which appear only in the rivers and lakes of South America and Asia, puff their way through the forest, 2,000 miles from the sea. And a butterfly drinks a turtle's tears for the salt they contain. As the river level drops, butterflies settle on the sandy shores, probing with their long tongues for dissolved minerals. A great egret skirts the unbroken wall of trees and heliconias, behind which the life of the forest itself hides. Here in the sun, on the edge of the river, yellow-rumped caciques display to their females. They're busy weaving nests like hanging baskets. Beyond the river's edge grows the least known and most complex forest on the globe. There are 30 times as many kinds of trees as you'd find in a typical North American woodland. Their thin trunks stretching upwards towards the light. Leaf jostles with leaf to capture the strength of the sun with their green chlorophyll. At last, 100 to 130 feet above the ground, more than 10 stories high, the tallest trees begin to spread their branches above the canopy of their lesser companions. One and a half million square miles that are almost completely unknown. Scarcely anybody has seen the canopy of the Amazon rainforest as close as this before. Here the trees offer their flowers and fruit to passers-by, like the yellow-rumped cacique. The parakeet feeds on nectar and pollen. The round things like berries are flower buds. They unfurl for the benefit of birds, which carry the pollen from flower to flower. These upper branches are home for dozens of species of monkeys. This is a white-lipped tamarin. He's after nectar or pollen too. Nectar gives sugar and pollen protein. He too pollinates the tree. Many kinds of trees mean many kinds of flowers and seeds, and many ways to scatter those seeds far and wide. A fast-growing cecropia tree climbs into a gap left by some fallen forest giant. For birds, its huge banana-like fruit is soft and tasty, and the birds have grown bills to match, like this golden-collared toucanet. The birds eat the tiny seeds, but many pass unharmed through their stomachs and are scattered in their droppings. Scarlet macaws are among the biggest birds in the rainforest, with immensely strong beaks to crush seeds. But some smaller seeds may be swallowed whole and scattered far away on fertile ground. Parakeets attack the pods of one of the balsa trees. But perhaps the most productive tree is the fig. Its millions of tiny fruits attract monkeys, such as this squirrel monkey. This is a spider monkey. It holds the twigs and bites off the figs. While the black capuchin picks them with its fingers like a greedy child. Prehensile tails occur only on New World monkeys, which are supremely adapted to trees. For a few days, while the fruit is ripe, there may be five or six kinds of monkeys feeding together. The red wakari. The trees seem loaded with flowers and fruit, but the rivers which flood around their trunks carry little food. Many of the 2,000 kinds of fish in the Amazon eat fallen fruit or seeds, and some help to disperse the seeds through the forest. A piranha lurks in hiding, ready to dash out and snatch a mouthful of any passing fish. Of course, they're famous for attacking animals, with teeth sharp enough to sever a man's wrist. But surprisingly, piranhas also eat fruit. Their relatives, the pacu, migrate hundreds of miles and carry undamaged seeds inside them, spreading trees throughout the flooded forest. Fishes and forest have evolved to help each other. But there's more than one kind of forest. This water is black. Leaves contain tannin. In normal soils, clay captures the tannin. But 1/15 of all Amazonian forest grows on pure sand, not soil. So the tannin stains the water as dark as tea. It seems a miracle that anything can grow on pure sand, but Amazonia is a miraculous place. All the same, there are fewer kinds of trees, and the monkeys have to make do without figs. These are yellow-handed titi monkeys. Most South American monkeys eat leaves and fruit, but the white sand forest is short of nutrients. The trees are small and produce fewer leaves and smaller fruit. A young monkey soon learns that the old leaves taste nasty. They're full of unpleasant chemicals to stop insects from eating them. But the insects themselves are more plentiful here, and the yellow-handed titi monkeys have learned to eat them as well. Sloths hang high in the treetops. In close-up, it doesn't look so cuddly. Its fur is alive with moths. Sloths may be slow, but they're regular. Once a week, the adults climb down to leave their droppings on the forest floor. This is the cue for the moths to disembark. They lay their eggs on the dung, where their larvae later feed. When the pupae hatch into moths, they then fly up into the forest canopy to find another sloth. Three-toed sloths are almost helpless on the ground, but few animals are so well adapted to coping with life in the trees. They also have algae growing in their fur. It turns them green, making them less conspicuous to the eagles that hunt them. However eagle-eyed a bird may be, it will have difficulty seeing anything on the dark forest floor beneath the sunlit canopy. The yellow-headed vulture hunts by smell. In the tropics, a dead animal rots quickly, and within a few hours, the yellowheads have found the spot where a monkey was killed by falling lianas. This is still 65 feet above the ground. Another bird has watched the yellowhead circle down, the king vulture. Larger and fiercer, he drives off the yellowheads. The condor of the forest. A young king vulture waits his turn nearby. It's not only the vultures that gather to scavenge. As the limbs drop to the forest floor, butterflies appear to scavenge for salt and other minerals from the flesh of the monkey's hand. Butterflies, in turn, fall prey to giant spiders. Around the edges of the web wait other spiders, tiny compared with the legs of the owner. They wait for the leftovers, one perched on the giant spider's belly itself. If you're unavoidably detained, like this dead lizard, things can happen fast. In a few hours, sweat bees have found a meal. Already, the flesh that made up the lizard is building other bodies. And 24 hours later, all that remains are the larger bones. Nothing is wasted. The tall trees shut out the light, but the rainforest floor is not so much a fearful world as one of bewildering complexity. A collared peccary, a kind of pig, and a large tortoise are accustomed to this world of shadows. One of the world's smallest monkeys is the pygmy marmoset, weighing less than a pound, watching a band-tailed mannequin dance. The branches and leaves that fall constantly from the trees rot quickly. Fungus claims them. These are just the fruiting bodies which disperse the spores. Below, an unseen network of hyphae breaks down the dead wood, releasing chemicals to be used again by the trees. Even the fungus is food for the peccary. Other animals eat the wood itself, like this cricket with its monstrous eyes. A termite column has consumed one fallen branch and is marching to find another. The scurrying workers are defended by guards with huge jaws and chemical spray nozzles on their heads, but raiders still attack. A solitary wasp preys on the casualties. While another inspects its nest, hung under a leaf to keep off the rain. Each cell contains a grub, a future predator. In a world of hunters and hunted, caterpillars have adopted fancy dress for defense. Eye spots make them look like something much bigger and nastier to a hungry bird. Even plants don't all stand passively by, waiting to be eaten. Alongside this tattered malastone grows another, strangely unravaged. It has its own bodyguard of tiny aggressive ants. The plant provides a special chamber for their barracks and hairs to discourage ant-eating birds. The Triplaris tree looks like any other, but at the foot of its trunk is a curiously uncluttered area of ground. It's an ant tree. Every twig is a hollow passage filled with vicious biting ants, a centimeter long. No caterpillar has safe conduct here. Even armor-plated beetles venture here at their peril. Out of special knot holes in the trunk swarm the avenging ants. The beetle mistakenly tries to climb to escape. The hollow twig above clearly shows the ant channel. For insects, there are other dangers crouching in disguise. A praying mantis. The rainforest, the most complex of all living systems, is possible because of the constant warmth and rain. Below the canopy of the jungle is one of the most unchanging climates on Earth. Here, the white capuchin monkey has learned to open the tough palm nuts by holding one in his feet and bashing it with another. While its parents eat their fill of figs, a young spider monkey plays in the treetops. Enjoying his mastery of a three-dimensional world. The colors of sunset draw out new sounds from the forest. With nightfall, a different play begins on the same stage. Half the day is spent in darkness, and as the monkeys sleep, new players take over. All we know of them are their voices. Or a lucky glimpse caught by moonlight. The jaguar. In the treetops, the kinkajou, a prehensile-tailed carnivore, is stripping the pods of a bean tree. It eats almost anything. Frogs come out of hiding as the air cools. Hundreds of kinds of bats live in the forest and dominate this unseen half of its life. They pollinate flowers, spread seeds, catch insects, and this one, Trichops, catches frogs. Dawn, along the Tambo Pata River, Tres Cruces, Peru. In the early morning, both green and scarlet macaws flutter down and cluster round a cliff. They have flown in from miles around. There is some chemical in the mud cliff that attracts them. Perhaps it's salt, but like many other things in the Amazon forest, nobody knows for sure. Macaws have always been prized for their magnificent plumage, and where there are plenty of them, it's a sure sign that the jungle is undisturbed. A third of all the kinds of birds in the world live in South America, and of them, the macaws are perhaps the most splendid. The Amazon has only just begun its journey. There's another 1,000 miles for it to roll before it meets the sea. 4 miles above looms Cotopaxi, defying the sun with its snow. The Andes gave birth to the Amazon, and now they veil its mysteries with their clouds.